The two-minute message preview at the non-denominational New Hope Olympia is entitled, Blessings Through the Blood of Jesus. Many of us have donated our blood at least once to someone. Donating blood for the very first time may cause some to be a little fearful and apprehensive. For some, donating blood for the first time may cause one to be a little dizzy. However, many donate their blood quite a lot of times after that. What causes people to become motivated to donate their blood? One thing that motivates us to donate blood is that someone else's life will be saved because of our blood. I'm sure you might have seen this written in the hospitals donate blood, save a life. The Bible tells us in Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11, that the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I, God, have given it to you upon the altar to make atonement for your souls, for it is the blood that makes atonement for the soul. That is what the Word of God declares. Blood is essential to human life. The Bible tells us the most powerful cleansing agent in the world is blood. In fact, God created blood to be a cleansing agent. Blood cleans out the filth from your body. In your body, blood takes oxygen and other supplies to cells and removes waste and impurities. That is one of its primary responsibilities. No other cleansing agent known to man can purify our bodily system and the blood that courses through our veins. So also, no other cleansing agent known to man can rid your soul of its filth and shame than the blood of Jesus. The title of Pastor Dell's weekend message is Blessings Through the Blood of Jesus. A lot of us either don't know, or we have forgotten the blessings that we receive through the blood of Christ. In his weekend message, Pastor Dell will talk about the five blessings that we receive through the blood of Jesus. We need to remind ourselves of the blessings we obtain through the blood of Christ so we can enjoy those blessings that God has for us. For the rest of the message, here is Pastor Dell.
And today I want to call your attention to Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 22. And here's what it says. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. And today, folks, the title of my message is Blessings Through the Blood of Jesus. I'm going to be sharing with you five blessings that we receive through the blood of Jesus. And so, folks, the first Sunday of every month here at New Hope, we celebrate communion. Some churches do it every Sunday, and that's just fine. That's in line with biblical teachings. But here at New Hope, we observe communion the first Sunday of every month. And here's what so often we say, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show forth of the Lord's death till he comes. And so the scripture says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 24, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And then the little cup that we hold in our hand, that's symbolic of the blood of Jesus. And here's what the scripture says. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, folks, I had a debt that I couldn't pay. And Jesus had a debt that he didn't own. And so he paid that debt for me and for everyone. That is the basic meaning and teaching behind ministry of communion. Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, as we bow our heads and our hearts in your presence, we thank you for your unspeakable gift. Thank you for your body. And thank you for your blood that was sacrificed for us as we receive this atonement as a reminder every time we partake in communion. And so today, Lord, I pray with a grateful heart. I pray with a humble heart. And I ask you to meet the needs of people in our church and in churches in our own community and around the world. And so, Father, for all you do, we're going to praise you and honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. So, what are the five blessings that we receive through the blood of Jesus? I'm going to be sharing those five blessings to you in this message. Billy Graham, when he first started his ministry, he said he received a letter from a professor at Cornell University. And Billy Graham said when he received that letter, he was very flattered by what this professor wrote in his letter. And here's what he said. He said, Billy Graham, you are a great communicator. You have the persuasion ability. And Billy Graham said he was just taken back by what this professor had to say about him. And the professor also said, Billy Graham, you will be very successful in your ministry if you will just leave out the blood stuff. As a matter of fact, this is exactly what he wrote. He said, because no enlightened man or woman will swallow it. Well, Billy Graham said after reading that letter, he said, I made a new commitment to preach on the blood of Jesus harder than ever before. He said, I made a new commitment to preach on the blood of Jesus harder than ever before. You want to know something, folks? The blood of Jesus is an issue today. As a matter of fact, we don't hear very many sermons anymore on the blood of Jesus, but the blood of Jesus is an issue today. Do you realize, folks, I could name major denominations. I will not name them, but I could name major denominations who are deleting any reference to the blood of Jesus in their hymnals. They don't sing about the blood of Jesus anymore. They just don't want that blood stuff, so they say, in their hymnals to show up on the screen. Do you realize, folks, listen closely, my goal for 2022 is to know my Bible better than I've ever known it before, and I've studied the Bible all my life, but I want to know it better today than ever before. And I trust that's your commitment too, to read and study the Bible and to know it better than ever before. But did you know that over 1,300 times the blood of Jesus is mentioned in the Bible? 1,300 times the blood of Jesus is mentioned in the Bible. Now, folks, when it comes to singing in church, there's a wide variety of interest on which songs that we sing. Some like the praise and worship songs, and others like the hymns, and some like the blended worship of hymns and praise songs. But I tell you what, folks, I got a newsflash for you. When we get to heaven, we all will be singing a new song. According to Revelations, here's chapter 5 and verse 8 and 9. Here's what it says. Now, when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, you are worthy to take the scroll and to open the seals, for you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood, out of every tribe, every tongue. People and nations will be singing a new song about the blood of the Lamb. So here's my thought, folks. It's just logical. If we're going to be singing a new song about the blood of the Lamb in heaven, then we ought to be singing down here on earth about the blood of Jesus. We ought to be singing about the blood of the Lamb. Now, when we talk about this issue of salvation, what it means to be born again, I want you to see five things that we will receive when we remember why Jesus shed his blood on the cross. Some of us have never heard a message on the blood of Jesus, and others of us since we haven't heard it preached for so long, we have forgotten what the blood of Jesus really represents. And so I want to say to you today, folks, in this message, there are blessings that we receive through the blood of Jesus. Number one, it all starts with the blood. It all starts with the blood. See, this is what I believe happened. God created a man. In the beginning, in Genesis, the book of Genesis, we find out that God created Adam. And I really believe that God looked at him over from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. He scrutinized Adam, the man that he created. And after he looked at him and after he studied him, I believe that God said, you know what? I think we can do better. And so you know what he did? I believe the Bible says that he created a woman. That's what happened. The Bible says he created male and female. He created male and female. So folks, we have a choice to make. Are we going to live by the principles of the Bible? Are we going to be sucked in to the teachings of our culture? That's a choice that all of us have to make. I don't know about you, but as for me, I choose to base and build my foundations for my life upon the Word of God. And so, in the beginning, He created male and female. And here's what I say, when given the opportunity to young boys who asked, who am I supposed to be anyway? I will say, you're supposed to be a male. And that young lady who says, who am I supposed to be? I say, you are supposed to be a female. God created male and female. Somebody says, well, you know what? I'm so struggling with my identity. You don't have to struggle, folks, because you're a male. That's who God created you to be. You are a female. That's who God created you to be. Listen, folks, we don't need males participating in athletics and swimming in women's sports. You're a male. You're supposed to be participating with males. And I'll tell you what, you might say, well, Dill, I don't like what you're talking about now. I'll tell you what, you really won't like it when a 22-year-old man walks into the restroom where your 9-year-old daughter is because he feels female on that day. We better stand for something, folks, or we'll fall for everything. So, the Bible says that God created male and female, and the Bible says that they sinned. Look what the Bible says in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 7. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And so here's what they did. They sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. Up to this point, they were without clothes. They were unashamed. They felt no guilt. They felt no condemnation. But after they sinned, the Bible says they knew they were naked. And here's what they did. They went and got some fig leaves and sewed them together to cover them up. You know, folks, that had to be very, very uncomfortable. Stop and think about it. They went and got some fig leaves. And you know what they were actually doing, folks? They were trying to deal with their sin and cover up their sin. Many, many times we do the very same thing today, folks. We try to deal with our own sin, and we try to cover up our own sin. Here's how we do it. Well, I'm better than so-and-so, so I'm okay. I was raised in the church. I went through catechism, so I'm okay. I was even baptized, so I'm okay. Oh, I was a member of the first church here and the first church there, so I'm okay. Folks, here's what we do. We try to cover our own sins by trying to get fig leaves, modern day fig leaves, to cover ourselves up. Well, I'm better than so-and-so. You know, I don't go to church, and here's why. The reason I don't go to church is because there's so many hypocrites in the church. By the way, whenever I hear that, that's nothing more than a cop-out. There hasn't been one person that has ever approached me and said, Dale, I'm not shopping at Walmart anymore because there's just too many hypocrites in that store. I promise you, folks, there are hypocrites who shop at Walmart. There are hypocrites everywhere. But you know what? That doesn't stop us from still shopping at Walmart. So you might as well get used to the idea of mingling with hypocrites. No matter where you go, there they are. Now let me tell you something, folks. I would rather go to church with a hypocrite than go to hell with them. I really, really would. So, Adam and Eve, they sinned. They felt ashamed and they felt guilty. And so they tried to cover themselves up, but it didn't work, folks. And just like when we try to cover up our sin, it just doesn't work. Look what the verse says in verse 21. It says, also for Adam and his wife, the Lord made garments of skin and clothed them with coats of skin. God said, Adam and Eve, you take those fig leaves off. I'm going to make coats of skin for you. Now get this, folks. What God did there was he made a blood sacrifice. See, in the very beginning, there was blood. That's why the Bible says in Hebrews 9:22, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. So why did he slay an animal and make them coats? Simply because nothing could take care of their sin except the blood of a sacrifice. And Jesus became the ultimate sacrifice. That's why he's referred to as the Lamb of God. Nothing can take care of their sin except the blood sacrifice. And nothing will take care of your sin. Nothing will take care of my sin except the blood of Jesus. It's the only thing. It's the only thing that's going to take care of our sin, the blood of Jesus. And so I want you to notice it all started in the very beginning with the blood. But I want you to see something else. Number two, it was a sacred blood. It's God's blood. It's God's blood. You say, well, does God have blood? Well, he did when Jesus was here. He did when Jesus was here. Dale, how do you say that? Well, do you know your Bible? Do you read your Bible? Acts chapter 20, verse 28. Here is what it says. Therefore, take heed to yourselves and to all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to shepherd the church of God, which he, God, purchased with his own blood. You see, folks, it took the blood of God. Let me tell you something, folks. It took the sacred blood of God to wash away our sin. And so, why did it take the blood of God, you ask? Simply because our sin was so great. There was a play in Jerusalem, Israel. In scene one, it showed a Jewish father, a Jewish mother, and their son. And the mother was fussing with the boy's father. And she said, why don't you quit making cabinets in the shop? I just wish that you would start making crosses for the Roman government. Our lifestyle would be so much better if you would quit making cabinets and start making crosses. That was the end of scene one. Then the curtains opened, and there was scene two. And in scene two, that little boy was running up to his father, and he was crying. And he said, Oh, Daddy, we made the cross that they crucified Jesus on. Father said, Son, no, we didn't make the cross. There were thousands of crosses that were made. And the son said, Daddy, no, we actually made the cross that Jesus died upon. And so the father said, Son, why do you say that? The son said, I got really close, and I saw something, Daddy. When Jesus fell carrying the cross, I also fell. And you didn't realize, but when you were finished for the day, I went back into your shop, and I wrote the name on a cross that we made. And when Jesus fell down, I fell down, and Daddy, I saw my name on the cross that Jesus was carrying. Folks, listen up. My name was on that cross. Your name was on that cross. Isaiah 53:5 says, but he was wounded for our transgressions. Romans 8:22 says, he who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all. So I want you to see, folks, it started in the very beginning with the blood. Number two, it was a sacred blood. It was the very blood of God. Number three, here's what I want you to see. It was shed blood. It was shed blood. Remember, the Bible says in Hebrews 9:22, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. Every once in a while, I'll hear someone sing a song, or I will listen to a message being preached by somebody, and they will talk about the spilled blood. And I'm thinking, spilled blood? No, it wasn't spilled blood. When you spill something, folks, it's an accident. I remember sitting at the table when our kids were growing up, and more recently when little Reese was at the table, and she would accidentally spill the milk. She didn't do it intentionally. It was an accident. And so when they sing about the spilled blood of Jesus, that simply is not true. Jesus shed his blood intentionally. It was not by accident. John 10:18, look what it says. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down. I have power to take it again. Jesus, he could have called 72,000 angels to deliver him from the cross. Did you know the Bible says that one angel destroyed 185,000 Assyrians? Jesus could have called 72,000 angels, but he chose not to do that because he was intentionally shedding his blood for the sins of mankind, for your sin and for my sin. It's always been, folks, the shed blood of Jesus. Now, you remember when the children of Israel were in bondage for 400 years, and God was going to set them free. At Exodus 12, we have the story. God wanted every family to get a lamb. He wanted every family to get a lamb, and he wanted to make sure that lamb was a baby lamb, and it was without spot or blemish. He said, make sure it's 1 year old. And on the 10th day of the month, God said, I want you to bring that lamb into your home. The Bible says that God told them to provide special care for that lamb. So every family in Israel would get a little baby lamb, 1 year old, and they would take that baby lamb and they would take care of it. And they would love on that baby lamb. They would get attached to that baby lamb. That baby lamb became a part of their family. They loved that lamb so much, they became attached to it. What was God trying to say, folks? What was he saying? God was sending a message to the people of Israel that he was attached to his son. Jesus was with God from the very beginning, folks. And when God said, "Let us make man in our own image," Jesus was with him in the very beginning. The Bible says the Word was made flesh. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. They were very attached. But God said to the families of Israel, "Now I want you to do something. I want every family on the 14th day to take that little baby lamb, and you take a blade. You take a blade, and you rip its little throat. And then you place it over a basin. And when that basin was full of the blood of the lamb," God said, "I want you to go to every house, and I want you to sprinkle that blood on the top of the door and on both sides of the door, because the death angel is going to pass through every house. And when that death angel sees the blood on top of the door, on each side of the door, when I see the blood, I will pass over." You know, folks, one day you and I are going to stand before God. And if we have accepted Christ as our personal Savior here on earth, we're going to stand before God in heaven, not because of anything that we have done, but we will be so happy when God sees the blood and he will pass over us. Folks, it started with the blood. It is sacred blood. It is shed blood. The fourth thing I want you to see about the blood is I want you to see that it is saving blood. It is saving blood. Genesis chapter 4. Verses 1 through 4. Look what it says. "Now Adam knew his wife, and she conceived and bore Cain, and said, 'I have acquired a man from the Lord.' Then she bore again, this time his brother Abel. Now Abel was a keeper of the sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought an offering of the fruit of the ground to the Lord.'" Verse 4, "Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat, and the Lord respected Abel and his offering." Now, folks, back up just for a minute. Notice what it says. Adam knew his wife. What does that mean? It means exactly what you think it means. They got married. And Adam said to Eve, "We're going to raise a little Cain when we get Abel." Folks, do you read your Bible? It's what it says. Adam and Eve got married. Abel was the keeper of the sheep. Cain was a tiller of the ground. So what did Cain do? What sacrifice did he bring? Well, he brought potatoes. He brought okra. He brought squash. He brought zucchini. And he offered it up as a sacrifice. And he said, "Look what I have produced. Look what I have done. Look how much I have worked. I planted the seed. I watered it. I hoed it. I fertilized it. Look what I have done." Look at verse 4. "Abel also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat, and the Lord respected Abel and his offering." You say, what's the difference between the sacrifice that Cain offered and the sacrifice that Abel offered? Abel said, "I brought a blood sacrifice." Cain said, I'm trying to do it myself. The Bible says, "For by grace are you saved through faith, not of works, lest anyone should boast." Because the only thing that God is going to accept is the blood. Spurgeon said it better than anyone. He said, "Morality may keep you out of jail, but only the blood of Jesus will keep you out of hell." Did you get that? Spurgeon said, morality may keep you out of jail, but only the blood of Jesus will keep you out of hell. A little girl was asked on one occasion, "Is there anything that God can't do?" And she replied, "Oh yes, God can't see my sin through the blood of Jesus." Folks, here's the fifth thing I want you to see about the blood sacrifice. It is supernatural blood. It is supernatural blood. Folks, in a day when there's very little, if any at all, preaching on the blood of Jesus, why, I should consider preaching a whole series of messages on the blood of Jesus. We should sing more often, more frequently, songs about the blood of Jesus. It is a supernatural blood, folks. Now, you may ask, "Well, Dale, how relevant is it? Just how meaningful, just how important is the blood of Jesus?" I want to report to you folks that it is extremely relevant. It is extremely important. As a matter of fact, there are five blessings that we will receive when we believe in the blood of Jesus. Blessing number one is it gives us access to God. It gives us access to God. Ephesians 2:12, look what it says. "That at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world." Notice it doesn't say little hope. It says you have no hope without God. Now, on the screen, there's a photo of the layout of the temple. Number one, that's the Holy of Holies. Number one is the Holy of Holies. That's where the high priest, once a year, went into the Holy of Holies. That's where he took and sprinkled the blood of the Lamb on the mercy seat in the Holy of Holies to atone for the sins of mankind. That's number one. Now, where are we? We're down there in number 12. You see that on the screen? That's the court of the Gentiles. We were in the court of the Gentiles, and even if we tried ourselves to get into the Holy of Holies, it was punishable by death. So we were at the court of the Gentiles. God was way up here in the Holy of Holies. The scripture says there was no hope for us. But look what Ephesians 2:13 says. "But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ." How did we get from number 12 to number 1? Where the priest was. The Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 5, look what it says, "To him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, he has washed us," the Bible says, "from our sins in his own blood." Look what verse 6 says, "And has made us kings and priests to his God and Father." Folks, we went from number 12, let that sink in, we went from number 12 up to number 1 where the high priest was because of the precious blood of Jesus. That's why Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 and 15 says, "Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. He was tempted in all points like we are, yet without sin. Now get this down, folks. Look at the next verse. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Today, folks, we can talk to God anytime, anywhere, because of the blood of Jesus. We can practice the presence of God anytime, anywhere, today, because of the blood of Jesus. I tell you what, folks, that ought to make us want to clap our hands more, raise our hands more in worship, because the blood of Jesus gives us access to God. That's blessing number one. Here's blessing number two. The blood of Jesus justifies. Look at Romans 5 and 9. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Folks, there had to be a payment for sin. It either had to be pardoned in Christ or punished in hell. There had to be payment. Now, how are we saved from wrath? Well, we are justified by the blood. Now, what does that word mean, justified? It means just as if you have never sinned. That's what it means. As far as God is concerned, it never happened. Isn't that good news that you can use? I say so. You were justified. As far as God is concerned, that sin that I have committed, the sin that you have committed, it never happened, because we have accepted the blood of the Lamb and we have become justified. That ought to make a backsliding Methodist shout hallelujah, folks. When I think about what the Lord has done for me, think about it. Think about what the Lord has done for you. It's truly wonderful what the Lord has done. My, oh my, we've sung that hymn a million and one times as I was growing up in the church. It's truly wonderful what the Lord has done. After we would sing a verse of that song, we would have pop-up testimonies, and people would stand up, and they would give their testimony on how good God was and what God has done and is doing in their lives. It's truly wonderful. And we can sing that because we have been justified. Blessing number three, the blood heals. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. By whose stripes you were healed. Now, when we think of healing, we almost automatically think of physical healing. But folks, this is emotional healing. This is mental healing. Because I want you to understand something. For every person that is under the doctor's care for physical problems, there are three people under the doctor's care for emotional problems. And so, there's a verse that I came across in my research for this message. It's found in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 14. Look what it says. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, to purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Folks, I know you perhaps know some people. I know I do. People who are living in the past. People who are living in guilt. People who are looking in the rearview mirror of their lives. People who are swimming in this sea of regret. People who are living with shame. People who are living with bad memories. And there are people that I know, I'm sure you know some too, who are beating themselves up because there are events that happened in the past that they can't get away from. Folks, I want to tell you something. Apparently, the blood of Jesus can purge our consciousness. It can cleanse our minds. And folks, there are people today whose minds need the blood of Jesus. They really do. We just need to pray a short prayer and say, Lord, I need the blood of Jesus to purge my mind. I just can't seem to get over the past. I can't seem to forget what has happened to me. I've got malice in my heart. I've got bitterness in my heart. I've got shame and guilt in my heart. And Lord, it just stays with me. Can't get over it. And I find myself constantly beating myself up. Well, I tell you what, folks, if that's you, the only advice I can give you is to come by the precious Holy Spirit, come to Jesus and ask the Lord to purge your mind with His precious blood. That sounds simple, folks, but guarantee it works. There is a man by the name of William Cooper. This guy, William Cooper, committed suicide 3 times. He was so depressed. And folks, when I talk about depression, I want you to remember something. When you struggle with depression, and when you go through your seasons of depression, that does not mean that you are less than as a Christian. Doesn't mean that at all. Because you go through a season of depression, doesn't mean that if you are a Christian, you automatically lose your salvation. Doesn't mean that at all. Well, this man, William Cooper, he battled with depression. He battled with issues in his life. He would walk into a room and he would have these panic attacks. And so they asked Mr. Cooper, how did you get over it? And here's what he said. He said, the blood of Jesus purged my conscience. Folks, this is a true story. He said, after the blood of Jesus that I prayed purged my conscience, I wrote a song. What song did you write? He was asked. I wrote a song after Jesus purged my conscience. And here's what the song was. Here's the lyrics of that first stanza. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. Folks, that's a beautiful hymn, sung it many times as a kid growing up in the church. The enemy wants to stain your mind and my mind, but only the blood of Jesus can purge it, can cleanse it. All I'm saying, folks, is there's blessings through the blood of Jesus. Blessing number one, it gives us access to God. Blessing number two, it justifies. Blessing number three, it heals. Blessing number four, the blood cleanses. Look at what 1 John 1:7 says. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. Folks, John is writing to Christians here. Look what he says in verse 8. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Verse 9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Folks, let me give you a news flash. After I got saved, I bowed my knee for the first time at an altar when I was a teenager at a youth camp. After I did that, I sinned. Somebody said, if I got what I deserved before I got saved, I'd be in hell. Now, come up really close and look at me. If I got what I deserved after I've been saved, I'd be in hell. I've sinned. You say, Dale, how can you feel so comfortable and so transparent saying what you just said? I can say that because if the truth were known, folks, and if you would be honest with yourself, you could say the very same thing. All of us, we all have. Folks, I'm so grateful that verse doesn't say his son had cleansed us, but it says it cleanses us. It's in the present tense. It's in the present tense. There's a fountain that is continuing flowing with the blood of Jesus that cleanses us from all sin. And so 1 John 1:9 is a microwave reset button that when we become convicted by the Holy Spirit that we have sinned, we can pray that prayer, 1 John 1:9, and instantly Jesus forgives us, justifies us. As far as God's concerned, it never happened. Someone wrote a song, "The blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary will never lose its power. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power because it reaches to the highest mountain, flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power." There's one other thing, blessing number 5, that we see through the blood of Jesus, and that is the blood gives us power over Satan. The blood gives us power over Satan. Look at Revelation chapter 12, verse 11. "And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb." Somebody says, you know, Dell, if the truth were known, I've got a lot of things going on in my life that I just can't get over. I say, yes, you can. You can be a victor because of the blood of Jesus. You can overcome it because of the blood of Jesus. Let me tell you something, folks. Satan is no match for the blood of Jesus. Satan cannot handle the blood of Jesus. Satan cannot combat the blood of Jesus. Satan does not want to come close to the blood of Jesus. Oh, here's a thought. Think about it. If Satan could get under the blood of Jesus, he would be a saved devil. Think about it. But that will never happen because he cannot get under the blood of Jesus. He's no match for the blood of Jesus. Songwriter wrote the song, "Would you be free from the burden of sin? There is power in the blood of Jesus." There's power, wonder-working power, in the blood of Jesus. Believe it, folks. It's true. I close my message today with a story of Napoleon. He was celebrating with his generals, and he had a table, had a map on the table, and he had a wand in his hand, and he was pointing to all the countries that he had conquered. He pointed to Italy, pointed to Spain, pointed to Poland, Switzerland, Sweden, Holland, and then there was on that map England. And to identify England on that map, it was just a red dot. And he took that wand and he put it on that red dot and he said, "Had it not been for that red dot, I could have conquered the world, but because of that red dot, I have been conquered." Folks, I truly believe that Satan said, "Had it not been for that red dot, had it not been for that hill called Calvary, had it not been for the blood of the Lamb, I could have conquered them all. But because of the precious blood of Jesus, you and I, every believer, we're more than conquerors. Because of the blood of Jesus, this old world here, folks, is not our home. We're just passing through. Because of the blood of Jesus, we will not be defeated. Because of the blood of Jesus, if God be for us, who can be against us? You say, Dale, as I have listened to you share this message, if the truth were known, I'm not really sure that my heart is right with God. If the truth were known, I'm not really sure that I have a home in heaven when I die. And I would like for you, Dale, to pray for me. And so, folks, there's a prayer printed on the screen, and I would encourage you to pray this prayer with me. Just repeat this prayer in your heart, right where you are seated, in the privacy of wherever you are. Pray this prayer. Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner, but God, I'm sorry for my sin. I'm so sorry, I want to change. I believe you shed your blood for my sin, and I accept your blood. I accept your atonement. Thank you for dying for me. I accept your salvation. Now, God, thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for coming into my life. Thank you for saving me. So, folks, what have we learned? We have learned that through the blood of Jesus, there's blessings. We have learned that it all started, salvation all started with the blood sacrifice. It was a sacred blood. It is a shed blood. It is a saving blood. And it is a supernatural blood. And the five blessings that we receive through the blood of Jesus. Number one, access to God. Number two, it justifies us. The third blessing, it heals. The fourth blessing, it cleanses. And the fifth blessing, it gives us the power over Satan. I trust that you will write these lessons on the tablet of your heart and go back and review them from time to time. Now, folks, may God be with you. Go with God, and He will go with you. Jesus Christ, the Lamb.